Hey, everybody. Welcome to Word Balloon, the comic book conversation show. John Suntress here. Very excited about today's show. One of the deans of sketch comedy from the 60s and 70s, making amazing albums, creating incredible radio, Phil Proctor of the Firesign Theater. Now, you may not know the name, but you know some of his roles. He's the drunk French monkey in Dr. Doolittle. He plays Howard DeVille on all the Rugrats cartoons, films, and the spin-off show, of course, All Grown Up. He's been doing a lot of voiceover work in the last few years, but today's conversation focuses mainly on the Firesign Theater because they were really a big part of subversive sketch comedy in the 1960s and the 1970s, and their influence continued after, well, I guess they continued as the Firesign Theater, but also two of the members, Phil and Peter Bergman, would team up as Proctor and Bergman. They have their own body of comedy albums and television spots, things like TV or Not TV from the mid-70s. My favorite Firesign Theater bit, The Adventures of Nick Danger, Third Eye, was such a delightful thing that we even did it at our college. Sorry, Phil, we didn't pay your royalties, but we did it at Illinois State for a radio production project because they were so inspirational. They would do the technology tricks that rock bands were doing in the 60s with psychedelic music. They were doing it with comedy. And because of that, they were considered kind of subversive and didn't get as many network TV shots. NPR certainly did a lot of work with them over the years. If you're unaware of the Firesign Theater's work, I wanted to give you a taste of their comedy. This is from a very funny bit, The Tale of the Giant Rat of Sumatra, featuring Phil as the great detective.
Our labor's now completed. The great defective Hemlock Stearns and I, his patient doctor and biographer, returned directly to our lodgings at 99 Bakersfield Street. Thankful that for tonight at least, Londoners might sleep forever under a comforting blanket of thick English industrial fog.
Splendid.
That's it, Stearns. Splendid. The adventure of the swollen sock.
It's quite commercial. They'll eat it up, old bean.
Yes, it takes care of last month's rent, too,
well,
you see.
By the by, have we eaten up all those old beans, Flotsam? I'm famished. Go rat about in the cupboard and see, old man.
Well, I'll give it the old army try. We've been gone, you know. Probably spoiled.
Hello, what's this? This solution's turning blue. Not quite the solution I expected. That means the rat should have lived and the captain should have died, of course. Let's see. Norveticus ratus, Norveticus asses, mammalia, rodentia meridae. Here we are. That's black and brown. Eats electricity.
The rat's gotten to everything but this half tin of Uncle Sigmund's Peruvian cocoa powder.
That'll be all right. Did you know, Flotsam, that if rats were the size of English children, they could wipe us out in a week?
Shocking. I don't want to hear about it. Here's your cup.
Oh, thank you, man.
Milk, sugar?
No, I'll take it straight.
I'll just have some tea if you don't mind.
The body of work that the Firesign Theater produced is being archived by the Library of Congress. Phil asks us not to mention that, so we didn't. And you might hear it come up in the interview. But rightfully so. I mean, these are comedians. You know, if you talk to some people my age and stuff, then maybe a little bit older, everyone will smile because in a lot of ways they were the daily show of their time and would talk about the relevant culture wars. And of course, because of that, kind of like the talk with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar we just had, I really was interested in what Phil thought about what's going on today compared to the nonsense that he had to deal with in the 60s. So this is a great conversation, a guy who's really lived a life. Phil has come out with an autobiography called Where's My Fortune Cookie? It's available on Amazon and so worth reading. This is a guy who really was experiencing the 60s like, you know, you should. And it really had an amazing time. Documents, hanging out with Peter Fonda. You're going to hear some pretty amazing stories. Brandon DeWild, the kid from Shane. Come back, Shane, come back. Well, Phil hung out with him as an adult. And there's some pretty funny stories about him and Peter Fonda, the three of them hanging out. But also, God, you know, he really was friends with so many of the people of the rock and roll era right during that Summer of Love period, really predating it by a couple of years. Firesign Theater, they started the first Love-In. You're going to hear about that in the conversation. So this is a guy who really did live life and has survived to talk about it in very humorous ways. Where's My Fortune Cookie? The Autobiography of Phil Proctor. We talked to Phil on today's Word Balloon. It's all brought to you by the League of Word Balloon listeners. Thank you very much, League, for your support. You know, honestly, in a sort of secondhand way, I think the League has helped me out because it's put me on some PR lists. Going to the conventions and getting on the press list has put me on some press release lists and allowed me to make contact with people that not only get me interesting comic book guests, but also film and television guests and people from the world of comedy. It was just a year ago that I spoke to Tony Hendra of National Lampoon. And this conversation with Phil is kind of in that same realm. And it's because of, you know, again, being able to go to these conventions. And the people that help make it happen are the League of Word Balloon listeners. Thank you very much for your support. Just came back from New York. Had some more new contacts. And I'm looking forward to some of the guests that I will be presenting to you in the weeks and months ahead. And that's all because of being able to travel and, you know, make it happen, especially right now when I'm between full-time jobs, thanks to the League of Word Balloon listeners. If you'd like to subscribe to Word Balloon, you can do that via Patreon. If you go to patreon.com/wordballoon, or right there on the front page of wordballoon.com, there's an ad. Click on the ad there. It will take you directly to my Patreon page. Do you think Word Balloon is worth the price of a comic each month? Do I give you that much entertainment? I hope so. But if you think it's worth your while, you can subscribe to Word Balloon by going to our Patreon page, patreon.com/wordballoon, or click on the Patreon ad right there on the front page of wordballoon.com. Thank you very much, League of Word Balloon listeners. Okay, without further ado, I want to get into this wonderful conversation with Phil Proctor talking about sketch comedy of the 60s and 70s. Album comedy, man. I know that comedians, you know, still make CDs and albums, but there was something about that big hunk of vinyl and opening the album art, not only the cover art, but the art inside. And Firesign was a classic example of that. If this is your introduction to the Firesign Theater, start hunting around because their stuff is everywhere. Of course, also you can buy their stuff at firesigntheater.com and also planetproctor.com for Phil's specific work. But it is just a delight for me to have this opportunity to speak to one of my comedy heroes. Here's Phil Proctor on Word Balloon. Phil Proctor, I was worried that the blinking lights wouldn't work for me, but everything seems to be recording now. Welcome to Word Balloon. It's a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be talked to. Oh, sorry. Are you sure everything's working okay there?
Huh? I'd expect no less. That's fantastic. Hey, I've been a fan since discovering the Firesign Theater well into your guys' run, unfortunately. It was in the early 80s. And, you know, it was your guys' kind of comedy that when I got out of school, I was really hoping jobs like that would still exist in radio because there was yourselves, the Credibility Gap, the Committee, you know, Python in Britain and stuff. And Chicago, we had the Usual Suspects that came out of Second City, and they were doing sketch comedy on the radio. I was really hoping that this was going to be a thriving industry when I got out of school.
Oh, yeah. Good luck. the Firesign Theater always said radio is a heartbreak, okay?
Yes.
Because it's a little bit like theater. It's like an amazing invalid, you know, or invalid if you pronounce it a little differently.
Totally.
We went from listener-supported radio on KPFK, where the Firesign Theater actually started on Peter Bergman's Radio Free Oz show, the first counterculture call-in talk show ever, from 10 to 2 every morning, more or less every morning, without morals every morning.
Indeed.
And then we went to commercial radio. We went to KRLA, commercial radio, and we did a live show called The Magic Mushroom there, where it was really kind of an early version of the parlor show, Perry Home Companion, okay? Peter would interview a musician Mama Cass or David Crosby. They play some songs, or a band even, and then the Firesign Theater would improvise as experts on something in a panel, and then we'd do a skit or two. We'd do like a goon type show.
Sure.
If anybody knows the goon shows that inspired us, and you know, with stand up microphones, and it was all in front of a live audience, and it was on, you know, every weekend. So that was a great thing. But then that came to an end also. And Peter went back on to kind of more of a traditional broadcast thing with Radio Free Oz. But we would – okay, one day we were going to do this we were going to introduce the pilot of a long-running serial called Nick Danger, Third Eye. All right? And we go out to the station that we were working on then. I don't know, KPPC or K-Piss on Me. I don't know what it was called. All right. We drive out to the station Sunday afternoon to get ready to do the show. And we found that our keys didn't work anymore. They changed the locks. Insane. The station had gone from, you know, talk rock radio to Hasidic country western. You know, overnight, they just changed the management of the station. And that's where we said radio is a heartbreak. But that's why Nick Danger, Third Eye ended up on the flip side of our record. How can you be in two places at once when you're not anywhere at all? Because radio was like that for us. How can you be in two places at once when you're not anywhere at all? That, you know, from your perspective, that's where we were. And in this instance, we weren't anywhere at all because they locked us out. But ironically, the Nick Danger piece, which we then adopted for recording, became our most accessible piece because it was a parody of detective noir dramas and radio shows, right?
Yep.
So more people could kind of say, oh, I see what these guys are doing. You know, they're taking a traditional form and they're bending it out. You know, they're smoking pot and then reading the scripts. Not quite as easy as that, folks, but I think that it made people kind of go like, this is really funny stuff. It's surreal. It's crazy. It's wacky. But at least we know what it's grounded on. You know, they could understand the reality that we were making fun of. And, of course, so many of our other albums were grounded on wonderful realities. But like Don't Crush That Dwarf, Hand Me the Pliers, which became our another one of, you know, our biggest sellers, was basically about television. Yes. And we invented the idea of channel surfing, click, 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 going from one place to another to tell a long form story. See? And then I Think We're All Bozos on This Bus was a computer. A predictive album about the computer world. And, you know, during the course of our conversation, I can tell you some more secrets about these albums and how they influenced the culture. But actually, come to think of it, it was because of Don't Crush That Dwarf, Hand Me the Pliers, which was inducted into the Library of Congress historical recordings, okay, along with Martha and the Vandellas and Jimi Hendrix catalog. We were flown down for a ceremony. This was during the Bush administration. The worst president. Oh, wait a minute. Not anymore.
Okay. Things change. Yes, right. Sir.
And the reason that I'm in New York right now, besides promoting my book, Where's My Fortune Cookie, mm-hmm. available now on Amazon, you know.
Indeed.
There we go. Is because David Osman and I, the Firesign Theater, or what's left of it, were asked to perform at the Library of Congress Coolidge Theater Thursday the 28th, evening of Thursday the 28th, to a sold-out audience of over 500 people. And that was in order to kind of announce, although they haven't done it yet, that they have acquired our archives.
Wow.
Okay? All right. So the Firesign Theater's archives have been acquired by the Library of Congress, but we can't talk about it yet because we're going to wait until there's a formal announcement. So don't tell anybody.
No, it's just between you and no one's listening to this. This is
just
fun.
Between me and a million other people. Yeah, and that's right. And yet, nonetheless, it was very, very exciting. And it was a wonderful opportunity to meet, you know, Washington fans and New York fans. Gosh, people came from far and wide, I think, you know, Hoboken, to come and see us. It was a great deal of fun, and another aspect of what Firesign Theater meant over our 50-year career. But who's counting, you know? The fact that people stayed with us and, well, is still alive. I mean, that's a good thing.
Yes. So,
absolutely. It was a lot of fun. But anyway, I've talked enough. Thanks very much. It was great talking to you. Goodbye.
Absolutely. No, this was great. Great validation and well-deserved. Absolutely, man. You guys were groundbreakers. And I love the fact that clearly, and this is something that, you know, as I get older, I'm fascinated by the comedy album era. And you guys were innovators. And much like the musicians of your period that you were very, you know, familiar with, intimate with, you were innovators of sound in sketch comedy in the same way that they were twisting the knobs on their music and adding layers and levels of sound that just wasn't thought of before.
That's right. Now, we when we got together on Radio Free Oz, the four fire signs, I'm a Leo, two Sagittarians and an Aries, Phil Austin, David Osman, Peter Bergman and myself. Peter and I had worked together at Yale. He'd written the lyrics for a couple of musicals that I'd starred in, Booth Is Back in Town and Tom Jones, written by Austin Pendleton, whom I'll be having dinner with tonight. Okay, and then we met up again when he was the Wizard of Oz doing the Radio Free Oz show, and we started improvising together, all of us, and discovered, because we all loved radio. We had radio in common. We had surrealism in common because we loved the Goon shows.
Yes.
You know, and if anybody doesn't know the Goon shows, Google them and listen to them. They will still blow your mind. They just, you know, they did the most wonderful, freeform radio stuff, right?
Right. We can't hide the names, Peter Sellers and Spike Mulligan. And you, and forgive me, you tell me the other two goons, Harry and
Harry Secombe.
That's right.
Spike Milligan,
right?
Okay, the Irishman, Peter Sellers, and then there was another guy, the fat guy. But I can't Google him now because I'm looking at your picture on Skype. But you know, if you check out the Google, you'll see. And they all did the most extraordinary voices and characters, crazy, way out, far out stuff. And that inspired us. And later, it inspired, of course, the Monty Python boys.
Absolutely.
You know, who, when I've talked to them and hung out with them, we all had that in common, and it was a wonderful bonding source for our surrealistic, crazy comedy.
That was what was great was you guys were all at different parts of the world. Alan Moore, the wonderful writer, talked about how the steam engine was invented in, like, you know, Fulton did it here, but there was an Italian, you know, over there doing the same thing. And it was just in the zeitgeist that everybody kind of, it you know, gravitated to the same ideas and went to the same places. So it's kind of neat. And I'm really happy to hear that it sounds like, you know, you're friendly with the Pythons.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But the thing about, as you expressed, what the Firesign did was we wanted to bring the power, the energy, the magic of radio, of audio, of movies for the mind to the modern era, into the modern century. And we, luckily enough, were given a contract, spoken arts contract, that gave us unlimited studio time.
Wow.
Okay, so we could write material, go in, record it, listen to it, go back, write some more, go to the studio, write some more, and until we were satisfied that we could finish the album. And that was an amazing freedom that we had. Plus, as you suggested, we had at our fingertips all of the instrumentation and the technology of rock and roll music, of being able to overdub, uber alles, as we called it, you know, and to add layers of things and background voices and music and atmosphere and sound effects, which at our leisure, more or less, you know. And we designed ways of recording in the studio at Columbia. We were actually recording in converted old radio studios, which was even more magical. And we were able to design, because of the size of some of these studios, long takes where we could actually walk from one microphone to the other, you know, to finish the scene if we needed to. We had amazing liberty to create things. And we were constantly inspired by the innovations of the Beatles, right?
Yeah.
Because they, under George Martin's directorship, production genius, they were also layering their albums and expanding their ability to tell a story in a song in the most extraordinary psychedelic and surrealistic ways. So they were great inspiration for us. And that's why we make references to the Beatles in many of our albums.
Especially, I remember in Nick Danger, Third Eye, and Cuckoo Cachoo.
And you were
Rocky. Were you Rocky Raccoon or Rocky Rococo?
I was Rocky Rococo.
Yes.
And so far as I know, I think Rocky Raccoon came out after Rocky Rococo, although they didn't know of us until later when they were in America. I ran across I had a brief encounter with John Lennon in Los Angeles once, and I gave him a Papoon for President, Not Insane button, which you will see, you know, in one of their bed sit-ins that they did.
Yes.
He's wearing the Papoon Not Insane button.
That's outstanding. Yeah.
But I told them how inspired we were by them. And by that point, they were beginning to know who we were, because we were called the jesters of the rock generation. We were making fun of the seriousness of the anti-Vietnam War movement and the youth liberation movement that was happening at the time, so that people wouldn't take themselves so horribly seriously that they weren't able to stay in touch with their humanity and to communicate, you know, more lightheartedly with everybody else that was involved in the movement.
Understood. And in Where's My Fortune Cookie, there are encounters and experiences you had, not just with the rest of Firesign Theater, but also your own film career. And hell, you even were on early soap opera, or I should say,
yeah,
early video soap opera, in terms of The Edge of Night, which you had kind of a juvenile delinquent role on that show.
Yeah, that's interesting that you mentioned that, John, because I was a Yale boy. I graduated from Yale. I was born in Goshen, Indiana, but I was raised in Manhattan from an early age. And I went to Allen Stevenson School, and I went to Riverdale Country School, right?
Nice, Archie.
I went to your website, and I saw the Will Elder Memorial, where he's parodying the Riverdale, you know, the Archie comics, right?
Yep.
Yeah, well, I went to that school, as did the person who created Riverdale. So, well, why is Riverdale Country School exists? So anyway.
That's awesome.
All right, with all of those – the schooling behind me, I finally made it up to Yale, and I decided to be I was a Russian major. I was a Russian major to the last half of my junior year, because I was working in the DRAMAT, the Undergraduate Dramatic Association, with people in my class like Sam Waterston, John Badham, who did Saturday Night Fever, Richard Maltby Jr., who wrote musicals on Broadway, Peter Hunt, who directed on Broadway, and Tom Ligon and Skip Hannon, and all kinds of wonderfully, wonderfully talented people. Austin Pendleton, writer extraordinaire, actor, teacher, philosopher, playwright. And because of this, I got an agent from something that I did, a musical called Man Beta Man by Errol Hill, in which I played a mulatto opposite Joan Van Ark.
Wow.
And Dan Travanti.
You know, from Hell Street Blues, certainly Daniel Travanti.
It was a heady time.
Wow.
And so I get this agent, and I took the train down to New York to read for the part of a juvenile delinquent on The Edge of Night, which was a live soap opera at that time. So they taped it. It was really early in the use of tape technology, but they videotaped my audition. And then I went down to get back on the train, and I'm walking across Grand Central Station, and I hear, "Will Philip Proctor please report to the station master's office?" In the middle of Grand Central Station. I stopped, you know. "Will Philip Proctor please report?" I said, "Okay, I'm coming. And I went to the information booth in the center there, the big area, and they said, "It's over there." And there were a bunch of people in conductor suits, men in conductor suits, sitting at big desks. And I go over and I say, "I'm Phil Proctor." And he said, "Call your agent." Oh, my God. So I go and I'm in the payphone. I call my agent. And he said, and then she said, "You got the job."
Wow.
It was like, what, an hour after I read this kind of thing would never happen today. You know, there'd be a million suits. I'd have to sleep with Harvey Weinstein. You know what I mean?
Good timing. Yes, sir.
Right? Or at least, you know, watch him take a bath or something, you know. So anyway, I had the job. And indeed, my first job graduating from Yale, before I graduated from Yale, was Julie Kurtz on The Edge of Night. And it was such a thrill because, you know, it was like doing an acting exercise every day, and you had to learn these lines, but they had teleprompters.
Okay.
Okay. And now it was all live. So the pressure that you were under was really kind of extraordinary. If you made a mistake, you made a mistake, you know. You'd have to learn to cover for it and everything. But I got contact lenses, and I learned to use the teleprompters. And then they went to tape. It was one of the first shows that went to tape.
Okay.
So, right? So I could experiment. You know, if I went up on a line, I could look over at the teleprompter and I could cover it and all of this. And then I could go home, and in 2 days, I would see my performance. And I'd go, oh, you couldn't tell I was reading from the teleprompter. You know, and this whole weight just fell from my shoulders. And I realized, hey, we could get away with a lot of stuff on television. You know? And it was a wonderful learning process for me. And then I started doing things. So the point is, I had a very traditional introduction to theater. You know, I went from that to off-Broadway, and from off-Broadway to Broadway, understudying Rolf in a time Sound of Music.
Wow.
Okay. And I and Richard Rodgers coached me. He coached everybody who went into that show, and I got all kinds of summer stock work and touring work playing Rolf all over the country in the years to come, with all kinds of wonderful actresses like Gloria DeHaven and I can't even remember all their names, but it was a wonderful introduction to theater. And it wasn't until I did a little musical called The Amorous Flea, which won a lot of awards, including a Theater World Award for me that Paul Newman presented, which was such a thrill.
Wow.
I know, amazing. And so we went out to Los Angeles. I'd never been to Los Angeles before, even though my uncle, Clarence Urist, was a production assistant in the movies out there. That's how I first got to meet Jerry Lewis, by the way. No, I got to meet Jerry Lewis because my grade school raised money, and I met him. I presented the check to him on live television in New York on one of the first telethons.
Oh, wow.
But later my uncle took me on the set of one of his movies when I was out in L.A., and I ended up actually working with him on television, and then I was in one of his movies called Cracking Up.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
That's a whole other story. But by the way, he always treated me as a perfect gentleman. He was never crazy or mean to me, although I can't say the same for my friends who worked for him. But, you know, he was fine, and he was fun to work with. And in any event, I was, you know, following a traditional path of theater. And I went back to do another musical called Time for Singing that Alex Cohn produced on Broadway with John Hearn and all these wonderful actors. It was a wonderful experience, but it was short-lived and closed. Then I understudied Brandon DeWilde in a straight play called A Race of Hairy Men by Evan Hunter.
Now, Brandon, and, real fast, Brandon DeWilde, a good friend of yours, and you talk about him in the book, was the blonde-haired boy in the classic Alan Ladd film Shane. Shane, come back, right?
Shane, come back,
yes.
Shane.
And in harm's way, where was this in context of him doing that World War II movie with John Wayne and Kirk Douglas, In Harm's Way?
He had just finished that.
Okay. That's a great performance too, by the way.
Yeah, that was kind of his last major Hollywood film. And he wanted to reinvent himself as a singer, and had taught himself to play the guitar.
Because of the craze of, you know, the good-looking kind of like how Tab Hunter was able to be a singer for years and some of these other, like, you know, certainly Frankie Avalon and then Fabian and those guys.
Well, something like that. It was just that he had this talent, and he wanted to exploit it and kind of just break the mold because music was really coming up at that time.
Sure.
Yeah, and we were hanging out with Graham Parsons of the International Submarine Band.
Yeah.
You know, the East Village was really jumping. Max's Kansas City was the place to be. And, you know, it was a growing subculture. That little did I know I was going to become a part of it in a little while.
Yeah.
Okay. But Brandon, in order to get some more movie work, he finally decided. Oh, and by the way, another strange coincidence. He had married the sister of one of my classmates at Yale. All right. Whose name is Susan Maugh. All right. So anyway, we drove out to California together, and we connected up with Peter Fonda. I don't even remember why, but we were hanging with Peter Fonda. We were the Three Musketeers, and one day Peter was doing research. Now, here we're going to get into something which is a little word balloonish, because Peter was working on a movie called Captain Marvel. No, Captain America. Excuse me.
Sure.
Captain America. That's what he wanted to call it. Remember, he was dressed in the American flag symbols and everything.
Yes.
But the comic book owners, was it DC Comics or Marvel?
It was Marvel. Yeah.
Yeah. They wouldn't let him use the name. All right. So he talked to his friend Terry Southern, who wrote The Magic Christian.
Yes.
And Terry Southern suggested that he call it Easy Rider because an Easy Rider is a guy who's living off of a prostitute. He's living with a prostitute, and she's paying all the bills. Got it?
Yep.
So Easy Rider became like that was what he was looking for, the Easy Ride, right?
Yep.
So anyway, he was doing research on this, and he can
what kind of research, Phil?
No, I'll tell you. Oh yeah, well he was doing some of that research, but you know, there was a demonstration that was going to happen on the Sunset Strip because they wanted to impose a curfew on the young people at that time who were, you know, openly smoking pot on the strip and protesting the Vietnamese war and just doing all kinds of naughty things children shouldn't do. And so we went down to protest with the thousands of other kids this curfew that they wanted to impose. And they brought the LA police out and they brought the sheriff's division out and they started the pincer movement on everybody, squeezing us all together. And we all like sat down, you know, in front of various clubs and things. And I sat down on an open copy of the LA Free Press and I sat down on Peter Bergman's face. I pulled this thing out from under my butt, and there was a picture of Peter Bergman, my classmate from Yale. And it said, KPFK newsman Peter Bergman interviews returning Vietnam War vets. And I said, KPFK, he's at KPFK, I got to call him. The next thing that happened was the police started beating everybody up, and the next day – I called Peter Bergman, and he said, yeah, I'm the Wizard of Oz. I said, what? He said, I have a show called Radio Free Oz, which is on from 10 to 2 every day. It's the first counterculture call-in talk show, okay? And he said, why don't you come down tonight and we'll play? And I said, sure. So I go down there to this dingy old studio with a funky round table with a velvet top on it and an ashtray for your joints and incense burning in the studio and everything. And I meet these two other guys, David Osman and Phil Austin. And it turns out that we're all fire signs, coincidentally. I'm a Leo. Austin is an Aries. And David and Peter are Sagittarians. And if you look at the cover of our album, I think Don't Crush That Dwarf, Hand Me the Pliers, you'll see us embodied in our various astrological fire sign symbols by an artist named Bob Grossman, who was Peter Bergman's roommate at Yale.
Wow.
Please. So this is what my book is about, all these incredible coincidences. So anyway, we started improvising together. It turns out that the four of us had this uncanny ability to play off of one another and to create different characters, almost like jazz musicians getting together and discovering that we could get into the groove with all of our different instruments.
Yep.
Yes. And Peter, the visionary that he was, he said, I'm going to call you guys the Oz Firesign Theater. Is that all right? And we said, sure, Peter, it's your show, anything you want. And the fact is that we started to attract a following. Peter was already famous. And at so we started doing crazy improvisations like the Oz Film Festival, where we showed movies on the radio and where we tried to show a risque movie on the radio. The living room, Blondie pays the rent, and Bergman said, no, you can't do that. We can't show a dirty movie on the radio. And the phones lit up. It was his listeners calling up saying, you can't censor them like that. Let them show the movie on the radio. Let them show it. We can't see it, and that was when we discovered that we had an audience that would follow us basically anywhere. All right. And then he created a thing called the Love-In.
Yes.
Which right, an event in Elysian Park in Los Angeles. It attracted 20,000 people.
Absolutely. Okay. Yes, insane.
The first kind of hippie gathering of its kind, long before Woodstock.
I was going to say, but what year was the Love-In?
The Love-In was probably 66 or 7, something
okay.
like that.
So that was even before, like, the Human Being, which was like that first San Francisco.
That's right.
It was, and everything. Yeah.
But it was definitely part of the movement.
Yes.
Like you're saying, there was something afoot. Something was happening, right?
Yes.
And you don't know what it is, do you, Mr. Jones? Something was happening. Dylan was happening. A new kind of storytelling and music was happening. New kinds of acts. Simon and Garfunkel and the Stones were emerging.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing about being a Columbia recording artist, which we were, was that at that time there was kind of like a bohemian a neighborhood that was created, and we got to rub shoulders with all these people. We got to hang out with or meet Dylan and hang out with the Stones and hang out with Phil Oakes, bless his heart, and other wonderful people of the time, because we were considered, even though we were just doing this multi-layered, complicated comedy that integrated music into it, but we were considered to be part of the family,
sure.
part of this new movement, you see, and that's really where when I started to change my own attitude about what I was going to do with my life, because this offered me an opportunity to be a producer, a director, a writer, a singer, a musician, and to have some effect on the society, the social fabric, the direction of the politics of the time. And where else could anybody find so much power, if you will, and so much family at the same time? It was just irresistible, and so I shifted my goals away from a traditional theatrical or film career or television career into this new, we didn't even know what to call it, the Firesign Theater event, and wherever it was going to take us, I was ready to go along.
You know, and that's the thing, you were part of the scene, and and afforded the same opportunities, as you say, as the bands of that scene. And it's amazing. Also, FM radio, freeform radio, I caught the tail end of it. I told you before we started recording, I'm 52, so I kind of remember like the last vestiges of it in the very late 60s, the very early 70s. But, you know, there was that freeform from my listener's standpoint. They did not understand it. You know, you'd go from a Grateful Dead song to a George Carlin bit or a Firesign bit. And, you know, so yeah, it gave you the opportunity to kind of again experiment in this same realm on the air, and then also taking it live. What was that like? Because a lot of your stuff, I mean, again, I only heard your records and stuff. So what was it like performing like some of this audio to a live audience?
Well, I'll tell you, if you go to the Firesign Theater site, firesigntheater.com, you'll see that one of the products that we offer is called The Duke of Madness Motors, okay? And it's a book, profusely illustrated. It's got a lot of my collages in it as well. And it's the story of our radio years, okay? And each one of us writes about, from our perspective, what we remember about that time when we were on freeform FM radio for an hour or 2 hours a night, improvising together and creating all kinds of crazy comedy. And it also has in it something like, how many hours? 80 hours of our material on an MP3.
Oh, that's great.
That's right. It's in the Duke of Madness Motors. And if I were back in L.A. and it was easy for me, I would get one to you right now. I will talk about that later. But it's something I know that you would enjoy. And what we were doing was, our live audiences would come to the studio and would sit on the floor around us, okay? So that there was always the opportunity to play to people who were hip to what we were doing. And that helped to inform us, of course, in the kind of stuff that we were playing with, because we could see what was working, you know, and it encouraged us also, of course, to play with one another. We also had a very inventive engineer on one of our shows, on the, I think the Dear Friends show, called the Earl Jive. And he would drop in sound effects and music unexpectedly on us during our improvisations together, or even our little scripted pieces that we were trying out. And we'd have to respond to them as well.
That's excellent. Right? Yeah.
So it was free form in more ways than one. And it informed us and helped us determine what it was we wanted to write about in for records. Because now listen. The main thing to know about what we were doing in records was it was uncensored.
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Because it wasn't really – we were not designing it to be played on the air. You would take it home and listen to it in the privacy of your own room.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yes.
Dorm room or under your bed or something, right? So that gave us enormous freedom to deal with themes and language and ideas – that did not have to be to go through any kind of a committee or be framed in commercialism in any way. Okay.
Yes.
It was very exciting.
Sure. Liberating. And it's again, coming from radio to be able to do your own thing. Hey man, that's, you know, podcasting, as I'm sure you know,
yeah,
that is the great. And by the way, feel free. I mean, again, as someone that has to work at their daytime radio job, it's always nice. And, you know, language is welcomed. Any form of language that best describes what you want to say, if it's dirty or not, it's okay here at Word Balloon. So,
well, fuck me.
There you go. There you go. Thank you.
No, but you know, that language per se, shocking language, was never the reason that we would do things. However, remember, we did that piece where we used all of the derogatory terms that people had for minorities, one minority had for another, you know, wops and kikes, et cetera, et cetera. We made a musical piece out of it. And right? And how can you be in two places at once when you're not anywhere at all? And it was called the American Pageant, right? And it was really, when you look at it now, what was it, in the late 60s that we did that? It was a celebration of diversity. Okay? And it called for – it ridiculed the idiocy of calling different minorities by different derogatory terms, because they were all minorities. We're all minorities. We're all mongrels. Yep. In a way. So that was very liberating as well. And most of those derogatory terms, by the way, are really terms of differentness, endearing. WAP comes from WAPA, which means pretty, you know.
Oh, I didn't realize that. That's okay. There you go.
Yeah. A sheeny, which is, you know, derogatory term for an Irish, comes from the word for beautiful. Sheena, sheeny.
I had no idea. That's amazing.
You see, it's because what the fear of minorities was always that some girl was going to fall for some handsome guy with red hair. Okay, you know you're Italian. There's this exotic guy with red hair who's really beautiful and smart and strong and handsome and everything. And your Italian daughter is going to go marry this guy. And no, my God, what are their children going to look like? And what's going to happen to the family? You see, so it's all about the attractiveness of different races to other people.
That's amazing.
And the fact that we were destined to intermingle and to you know, become one race.
Sure. Absolutely.
Right? We're all the human species. And that's the fun of it, really.
Absolutely.
So anyway, that was one of the things that we reveled in and revealed. But we also made fun of commercial radio and commercial television, which was verboten, and that kept us off of real television a lot of the time, because we wanted to deprogram people from the brainwashing that was going on in commercialism, which is basically, you know, making people buy things, right?
Yes.
And the politicization, the war fervor, and all of that stuff. Okay, so that's why, as you suggested, in freeform radio, they could drop in selections from Firesign, which sounded at first listen like, oh, this is a commercial for, you know, a car dealership. Hiya, friends, Ralph Sportsman, Ralph Sportsman Motors, the world's largest used nude and nude lewd automobile dealership, Ralph Sportsman Motors, here in the city of Emphysema. You know, it sounds real, but it's definitely not. And so the next time that they heard Ralph Williams, who was selling cars, which I based this character on, they would laugh at him.
Sure.
They'd go like, oh, this is funny. He's selling cars. And that it liberates. Again, it was a form of liberation and is based on, as I said in one of my other interviews recently, because I'm doing a lot of fun promotion on podcasting and things now. The main question that we asked in all our albums was in one of our earliest albums, Don't Crush That Door. And the question is, what is reality? What is reality? It's a question which is yelled out by a Latino character to the principal poop, you know, who represents the straight world in high school. What is reality, man? You know, and that's the question that I challenge everybody to answer, right? What is reality? We all have our own perspectives of that. And I think that every once in a while you have to kind of fact check yourself and see what you think. What is it that you really believe, or what is it that you want to believe, or what is it you'd like to believe, and take a look at, you know, what direction that is taking you in your life. Reevaluate yourself occasionally. It's just all a question of perception and self-motivation.
Again, that's why I think so much of your material still plays so well today. And I wonder back then, because you guys were obviously very subversive in the best possible way. Was Hoover and the FBI, were there files on you guys? Do you know?
Yeah. Yes, there were probably more individual files than there were Firesign Theater files. But yes, we were suspect. and I think it's one of the reasons why they kept us off of television. We did do some local TV. And we were on the David Susskind show.
Excellent.
And by the way, so some of our visual stuff has been released, which you can also get at the Firesign site. It's called the Firesign Theater Declassified, Everything You Know Is Wrong, right? And it's a two DVD set of some of our films and some of our television appearances. It's like almost 8 hours of stuff. And then we're going to be releasing more stuff before we have to send it all to Washington, D.C. for the archives. So, yes, our visual stuff, that which we were able to do, will be out there. But, you know, since this is a show about cartoons and graphic novels, I do want to mention that I had a fun career in cartoons and animated films.
Absolutely.
All right. And it started with Hanna-Barbera. Okay, because I was in the Smurfs.
Awesome. Yes, indeed.
I was, what was my character? King Gerard. King Gerard with my Clockwork Smurf. And there was a spinoff that they did called, I don't know, Harry and Eddie or something. Pee-wee and Herman. I don't remember what it's called. But with Michael Bell. But I got to work with great, great artists like Jonathan Winters.
Wow.
And Alan Young, and really, it was amazing the people that I would meet when I'd walk into those recording sessions. And I got to do work on all of the stuff that Hanna-Barbera was doing, because they were the cartoon factory at the time that I was out there.
Sure. This is early 80s, right?
Yeah. The 70s.
Oh, excuse me. Even the 70s. Fantastic. Wow.
The Jetsons and Richie Rich. And I mean, if you go to my to the IBDM or MD or whatever
it's
called.
IMDb, absolutely.
IMDb, and you look at the stuff that I've done, it amazes even me.
Well,
because it's impossible to remember all of the voices that I did for all the stuff that I did. But it wasn't until I got the part of Howard in the Rugrats.
Yep.
Later in my career, that I was able to do one character plus a lot of other characters, of course, for 14 years.
That's fantastic. Absolutely.
With a few breaks, that was the run of that show. And I also was able to add voices to Disney movies, starting basically with The Rescuers Down Under and then Beauty and the Beast, which incorporated the first computer animation in the ballroom scene. Remember?
Yes, indeed. Absolutely.
Yeah. And then from there into the Pixar movies, where I was able to do voices for Toy Story and A Bug's Life and Monsters Incorporated and on and on and on. And then also I do the voice of the drunken French monkey in the Dr. Dolittle movies. I'm a social lingo. We did five of those. So even though I was still doing Firesign Theater, because of the fact that we did voices all the time, I was able to get myself an agent and to branch out into these other areas, because it didn't require you to go to Broadway and rehearse for 2 months and perform for 5 years. You know, you could go in and do your work in an afternoon and then go back to what else you were doing. So it was something that fit into the rest of my recording career and the rest of the things that I was doing. And I could also do local theater, which was great fun, because that most of that was in the evening once you got the rehearsals over with. And then, I could work during the day and then go do a play at night. So I found a really nice niche for myself. And I've been married now for 25 years to my darling wife, Melinda Peterson. And we are in a theater company in L.A. called the Antilles Classical Theater Company, and have been for, 14 years, honey?
I've been there since 91.
Well, she's been there since 91.
Very cool.
Okay. Yeah, but we get to work together. And the other thing that we do together is a lot of live audio presentations of old-time radio shows.
Oh, that's great. Okay. Recreations of old-time radio shows. Fantastic.
Yes, we do those at conventions. We're going to be doing one at the REPS convention, the Radio Enthusiasts of Puget Sound, where last year Margaret O'Brien was the guest star there, looking beautiful and acting wonderfully, and that's one way to keep the spirit of radio alive, which is absolutely fantastic. And we do the same thing down here occasionally in a company called Fake Radio that recreates pieces and integrates improvisation into the work, and it's before a live audience, that both of younger people and older people who appreciate radio. And we've had some amazing experiences. We toured for a while in a show about Agatha Christie's early radio works on the BBC.
Oh, wow.
Agatha
Christie and the BBC Murders.
Oh, Agatha Christie and the BBC Murders.
As opposed to the ABC Murders. Fantastic.
Yeah, right. And we played down in Florida with that. And it was... Pardon me. my phone? It was an integrated show that had costumes and props and music and everything, and a phone like this from the audience.
Hold on, let me see what this is.
No worries. Take your time.
Wait a minute. Who's calling?
Philip Marshall. Oh, Philip Marshall. Okay, Philip Marshall is the producer, writer, creator, director of a piece called Francis Scott Key, After the Song, which is a three-part PBS series that's on the air at different PBS stations now. If you go to the site fskey.com, you'll find out when you can see it.
Cool.
And I play a major role in it.
That's fantastic. Go on.
I play a wonderful real historical character named John Randolph of Roanoke. Okay? And he was quite a character. And what Phil Marshall did with this wonderful idea, this wonderful documentary, is that he interviews the show is about Francis Scott Key's involvement in the early movement to abolish slavery in the United States.
Wow.
Okay. And my character was infatuated with Key and was working tirelessly for this cause, because I had inherited over 300 slaves and was horrified at the idea that people could own other people.
Sure. Wow.
All right. So anyway, that's what it's about. But we are all interviewed, these characters, as ghosts. So we're speaking in the real language that has been kept in all the books and the transcripts of what these people really said. And my friend Gary Sandy, who has done a lot of these audio presentations with Melinda and me, he plays President Andrew Jackson. He does it absolutely brilliantly.
Wow.
Okay, and it was because of him that I got involved in the project. I don't know what Phil Marshall's calling me about, But after I finish talking to you, I will call him back and find out what that's all about. So, you know, again, I've been very blessed in my career, as you'll see if you read the book, Where's My Fortune Cookie, that a lot of things, a lot of chance has happened, a lot of coincidence has happened, a lot of, I dare I say, psychic things have happened that have propelled me on my career and led me to the point that I am today, at the age of 77, still creating and still participating in the things that I love, and still actually making a kind of a living at it.
That's
so.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
It is amazing, and congratulations in doing that. Gary Sandy, for the people listening, may remember him as Andy from WKRP, the leader of the program director of WKRP back in the day. And
well, he was the boy toy on the show.
Exactly.
We always kid him about that, but he's a wonderful, wonderful actor and a terrific pal.
Are we pressed for time? Because if you do have to go, I'll let you go. But if we can go a little bit more, that would be great. It's up to it. But I totally understand if because we started late.
No, we can go a little bit longer because all I have to do is meet up with Austin Pendleton and Tom Ligon, two of my Yale classmates. Well, two of the people that I worked with at Yale in the Dramat. I haven't seen Tom for years and years and years. Wonderful actor, and it'll be the last thing that we do here in New York before we head up to West Hartford, where Melinda's family comes from, and we're going to end this trip on the Saturday night at Melinda's 50th high school reunion.
Fantastic!
What's the name of your high school?
William H. Hall High.
Very cool. That's excellent. Okay. Congratulations, Melinda. That's wonderful.
Then back to Los Angeles. For those of you who are interested in the paranormal aspect of the book, which we're not getting into too much, and that's fine because there's so many levels to my life.
Indeed. Go on.
But I will be on Coast to Coast.
Oh, that's great. I love that show.
Yeah, me too. On Saturday the 21st, I'll be on Coast to Coast, and I'll be talking about my UFO connections, my psychic connections, and all the other bizarre things. I'll just share one with
you. Please.
The book is called Where's My Fortune Cookie for a particular reason. Peter Bergman and I, when we branched off from Firesign Theater and toured as Proctor and Bergman, because we wanted to get out of the studio and go out and meet the people, and we also wanted to create records that were shorter form parodies, mm-hmm. so they could get more, you know, more play on, by now, commercial radio, right? Because the nature of the radio was changing. And it was harder for people to play complicated Firesign long playing material. So anyway, we're out on the road, and we were in the Golden Dragon Massacre in San Francisco, which was celebrated, or remembered, I should say, 40 years ago, September 5th this year, for being the worst mass killing in American history at the time. 40 years ago, 5 killed, 11 wounded.
Yeah, yeah.
5 killed, 11 wounded. The worst.
It was the worst 40 years ago, yeah, yeah.
The worst, okay? And Peter and I were there, cowering under the table, and we survived. And the aspect of that story that's particularly psychic and weird is that a friend of mine predicted to me about two months before it happened that I would be in a gangland shooting with foreigners after performing a show with Peter Bergman, and that people would be killed and wounded around us, but Peter and I would get out okay.
Wow. Yeah.
Pretty to me. All right. And of course, Peter said, you know, the next day we had to perform in Colorado, and I said, I ordered the duck. And Peter said, and I ordered the scared prunes. And then we said, but we never got our fortune cookie.
It's the title. That's excellent. Yeah. Yeah, it opens the book. And honestly, as you said, really, you've led this rock and roll lifestyle. I mean, it's fantastic in terms of the weird turns that your career has taken. But I think a lot of people who want to create, and a lot of listeners really get inspired by the cartoonists that I have and the writers I have and performers such as yourself, and they want to get into this. And it's really interesting that your career has taken these turns and afforded you these opportunities that, as you said, were never part of the original plan. And it's just made for such an incredible life. And you document it very well. I mean, really, this book is just outstanding with the stories and the cameos by these famous people. Marcia Strassman, a former girlfriend from who played Julie on Welcome Back, Carter, Gabe Kaplan's wife. You know, I mean, you know, I was Orson Welles and Tuesday Weldon, the Henry Jaglom film that you made.
Yes. Yeah, Safe Place. That's right. That was my first, really, and my only major starring role, except Tunnel Vision. I played the head of the cable station. That was a film by Neil Israel, which basically predicted cable television, right? and then Peter Bergman and I wrote Americathon.
Yeah, I was hoping we'd get into Americathon because I saw the film, and I'm glad to, you know, I would love to hear your guys' original take of it, because again, presaging a lot of, I mean, you know, the our current bankrupt country.
Yes. And the gas crisis and the oil crisis and all this stuff. That film, I just finished editing a book about that film on Bear Manor Press. That's another place you can go. Bear Manor Press, or Bear Manor Media, I think they call it, is a boutique shop that basically releases books about the radio, the history of radio, and the history of certain screenplays and things. So Peter Bergman and I, before Peter passed away, were working on two books. One of them is called Power, and that's out there now. And it's a transcript of this wonderful, funny radio serial that we did on John Hockenberry's Heat show on National Public Radio, right? It's a parody of the world of agencies and movie studios and everything in L.A. And my dear wife played prominent parts in it too. So the quality of the work was excellent, and the transcripts of the scripts are very, very funny. And the other book that's going to be coming out soon is called Americathon: From the Skit to the Screenplay. Or the skits to the screenplay, because Americathon came out of a piece that Peter and I started doing called Gothamathon, where we go into a town and we'd say, you know, you guys are going bankrupt. We have to raise money to save your city, you know, get the garbage trucks rolling again. Right. And then Peter would play this character called Jerry, who'd been up for 186 hours, you know, and he would introduce all these crazy acts. And we'd go off stage and come back as different people and different acts. And then we decided to expand it to Americathon, you know, because the country was in trouble, right? Neil Israel happened to catch the director and creative writer of Tunnel Vision, happened to catch one of our shows because he was out promoting Tunnel Vision. And he said, I want to make this into a movie. And that's where we got involved in the writing of it. At a certain point, we lost control of the project, and other people took over. So it's not truly a Firesign Theater or Proctor and Bergman surrealistic project. But nonetheless, it's become a cult favorite because it predicted so many things. Has a wonderful cast, Johnny Ritter and Harvey Korman. And, you know,
Elvis Costello.
Oh, yes, Elvis Costello, wonderful people, and Terry McGovern, if you know his work.
Yes.
And it's well worth seeing, again, because of the predictive nature of the film. Remember, people were living in their cars and riding bicycles all the time.
Right.
And
Oh,
my God. So, yes, Americathon is worth seeing, and the book is very interesting, too, because I've got transcripts of the Gothamathon show and the Americathon show, showing the evolution of how the piece developed and how it inspired. And Neil Israel wrote a wonderful foreword about it. And Steve Gilmore, who filmed Americathon at the Bottom Line when we did it in New York, he also has remembrances of what it was like at the time and what forces were around that helped to create that social idea. So anyway.
That's amazing. Well, I want people to be able to get some of this product and stuff. So you mentioned the Firesign website, which again is
FiresignTheater.com.
Could be simpler. And then your own site as well.
Yeah, well, I'm at planetproctor.com. And basically, I mean, the book is available on Amazon.
Yes, Where's My Fortune Cookie is out. It is available at Amazon. It's a great
one. It's getting great ratings, so please like it. And I think that it's starting to sell well. I wrote it because Brad Schreiber, my co-author, who has another wonderful book that's drawing a lot of attention out now called Revolution's End, which is about the Symbionese Liberation Army and Patty Hearst's story and all of that. He is not only a serious writer, he wrote the Hendrix story as well.
Wow, Jimi Hendrix story, cool.
Yeah, the Jimi Hendrix story. But he's a comic writer, and he teaches comedy writing, in school and things. So he was – and he's an old friend, so he's the perfect person to collaborate with in the creation of this book. And he really was the inspiration for me to do it. He said, "You got to tell your story." And I said, "Okay, but I don't have time." He said, "Okay, talk to me. I'll transcribe it." It's been a great collaboration. And I think the result is very worthy.
Could not agree more, and really was such a pleasure to read, because, again, your career has taken all these interesting turns, and also your writings have really presaged a lot of things that happened. Like you said, tunnel vision with cable and the internet, and you were of your times, and you were also ahead of your times in a lot of your writing. And I'm really glad that you're still out there performing and stuff, though, because it's a pleasure to have your voice out there. And also your perspective as someone who came up. I just had Kareem Abdul-Jabbar on, and I said the same thing to him. Yeah. So as someone who has observed the craziness of the 60s to the craziness of now, We need mm-hmm. people like you that really have a good handle on it. And well, actually, if real fast, I mean, and I, boy, let me hit you with the essay question at the end here and stuff. But yeah, comparing the craziness of now, the demonstrations that are going on now, to the stuff you experienced, 50 years ago and stuff. What's it like looking at it from both ends like that?
I feel like I'm in a Mobius strip, or I'm on a Mobius trip. It's like the loop de loop, I mean, things have not changed. The only thing that's changed is that I'm older, and the world has seemed not to have learned anything from the past experience. There seem to be forces in the world that are progressive and forces that are regressive. And the only way I've ever explained it to myself philosophically is because we live in a dual dimensionality. We have males and we have females, and then we have everything in between, right? And we have good and we have evil, and we have progress and we have nogress, and egress. We live, we die, we come in, we go out. And so everything is kind of like always in conflict of some sort, where it should be in balance. The whole Buddhist philosophy, the whole Tao philosophy, the whole Eastern philosophy is the balance between the forces, yes. the yin and the yang. And it seems like the Western societies just don't understand that. They believe that the yang should dominate the yin, Yes. There must be the people at the top of the pyramid, should dominate the people at the bottom of the pyramid, and actually are, even though they're supported by them, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Right, and so that's the conflict of culture and evolution that we still see, and it creates chaos, which is perhaps the natural state of humankind, And whether we ever achieve any kind of balance or any kind of loving acceptance, it remains to be seen. I would be delighted if I began to see even the beginning of it before I had to leave for another dimension and face other problems in the universe. But for the most part, even in the world of UFOs that I investigated, the story seems to be that the tall, spindly ones are the fascists, and they use other slave aliens in order to, you know, power their to get around the universe. And the little guys with the big eyes and the big heads, they're the ones who believe in universal love and they want balance in the universe. So even in the stories I hear about UFOs, there seems to be this yin and yang thing. Well, look, we've got, you know, the black holes and the red dwarfs. I mean, even in our slow, slowly evolving understanding of the nature of the universe itself, the being is as important as the nothingness, right?
I hear you. Absolutely.
Without the nothingness, the being would be all together and we'd be in another Big Bang, right?
Sure.
Once the Big Bang happened, everything goes flying out and there's space again, right? So I don't know the answers to it. I just don't know, but I've always been amused to be here. I've always felt like a stranger in a strange land, and I'm enjoying being able to observe it and to, you know, pass my judgment on what is reality and to ask important questions and make up answers.
I hear you, man. No, what is reality? Exactly. That's where we're come full circle, and it's that same question. And yeah, I wasn't expecting answers. I really was expecting more what you just said. So that's terrific. And again, I'm glad you're there to observe and interpret and share your point of view with us.
Well, I think I'm here to absurd, John. To absurd.
Where's My Fortune Cookie is the name of Phil's autobiography. Again, it's available now on Amazon. And it's been a pleasure, sir. I hope you'll come back when you have something new to promote, because we've barely scratched the surface. And I've really enjoyed investigating other interviews with you. Man, those series of interviews you did on Comedy on Vinyl were a pleasure to hear.
Oh, yes. Oh, you know those. Oh, yes. Yeah. I have to do some more. He wants to go through, you know, my reminiscences of every album that Firesign did. And I think I better do it before I forget, right?
Well, again, most of the story that we get from Where's My Fortune Cookie is absolutely worth reading. And again, Planet Proctor and FiresignTheater.com to keep tabs on the group and specifically Phil Proctor. Really appreciate your time today, sir.
It's been a great pleasure talking with you, and I look forward to our next encounter.
I'm telling you, the Firesign Theater were my comedy Beatles, and man, what a pleasure to talk to Phil Proctor. Where's My Fortune Cookie? The autobiography, available now through Amazon. Pick it up. It is so worth reading. So many funny stories, and cannot wait to have Phil back on for another round of Word Balloon, because as I said, there's so much more to talk about. You know, next time we'll talk about the animation and more Proctor and Bergman stuff as well. I honestly, what a great career, and really happy to share with the guy today. Thanks again for listening to Word Balloon, brought to you by the League of Word Balloon listeners solely today, because, you know, this is a comedy thing, and like I said, I think he deserves your support. I would say, you know, go out and buy some Firesign Theater material. Check it out. It's online. You can find stuff on YouTube to sample and see what kind of great stuff they have. But, you know, really, these guys really had comedy down and were innovating in such interesting ways. So I hope you enjoyed the conversation today. Thank you again, League, for your support. If you want to subscribe to Word Balloon, you can go to patreon.com/wordballoon or the ad on the front page of wordballoon.com. We'll talk again in a few days. We've got more interviews to share with you through October. And didn't record much at New York Comic Con. Didn't have the opportunity to, unfortunately. It was more of a networking trip. And I'm glad I did, because as I said, I made some, as I like to say, good love connections. So we got interesting interviews coming up in the days and weeks ahead. So keep it tuned here to Word Balloon. I'll see you in a couple days. Have a nice weekend. Until next time, Word Balloon is a copyright feature of Shaky Productions. Copyright 2017.